I'm Jon Caldara, president of the Independence Institute and your devil's advocate. Man, I love having former Governor Dick Lamm on. He is one of my dearest friends. So wrong on so many issues, but there's something about you more than any other Colorado politician where I think you challenge your thinking all the time. If there was somebody I would consider a free-thinking politico, it would be you. I don't think you have fallen into a box of, I'm a Democrat, so I have to vote this way. You've challenged, what issue have you moved the most on?
I hear about that all the time
from Democrats.
From my fellow Democrats, yeah. Oh, I would say the economy and the idea that I think that entitlements have set America up for a major, major economic trauma. I think that there's, when you look at the unfunded liabilities of the entitlements on top of the federal debt that we already owe, I just don't see any good, happy way out of that. And so I guess that's what preys on my mind. And also is where I went in with a very conventional Democrat thinking that Social Security, well, I mean, part of this is not change of my thinking. It's just become so apparent now that you've got unfunded liabilities that are just beyond our ability to fund. Something's going to have to happen, but nobody wants to touch the
And the longer issue. We wait, the worse that crisis is going to be.
Bingo.
I was listening to Colorado Public Radio, and they did an interview with you. Nathan Heffel did it, I think. And it blew my mind about the bill you sponsored back in 1967, 50 years ago, making Colorado one of the first states to legalize
yeah.
abortion. Now, I've known you for a long time. I have followed you ever since I was a puppy. And I had no idea
yeah.
that this was you. Tell me a little bit about what Colorado was like pre-1967 with abortion, because I just thought it had been that way for years and years and decades and decades.
Well, Colorado is a very conventional state on abortion, that it really did have the life and maybe even the health of a mother. Some people say that they were actually being, that the district attorney was not prosecuting if it was a matter of the health of the mother. Nevertheless, it was
so you could get an abortion if the mother's health was at risk, but nobody really enforced that. So you could make it happen, but it was a gray area. Is that a
well,
good way
doctors
to put it?
Are conservative, and I can understand that. They spent a lifetime in training, and all of a sudden they don't want to get on the wrong side of the law. And so it was very clearly that the life of the mother was very clear. The health of the mother was very vague, and the district attorney did not prosecute that we knew about for the health of the mother, but nevertheless, it was pretty much prohibited. And so my wife and I had spent our honeymoon in 1963 mountain climbing in South America, and we bummed around.
That's something the Lambs would do.
Yeah.
Yeah, we wouldn't go to the Cascades. No, you'd go mountain climbing and.
Fascinating trip, fascinating trip. But well, we ran into this question about how many of the hospital beds in South America were taken up by botched abortions. So, I mean, women were trying to abort themselves and other things like that. That's the first time it really had come to my consciousness. So fast forward to January of 1967, I walked into the Colorado legislature. John, I didn't know where the men's room was.
This was your first session, wasn't
it? First time.
And you were 32 years old.
32 years old.
Well, by the way, what were you doing for a living?
I was a lawyer.
Okay.
Yeah. And I walk out at the end of the session with my picture in Time magazine. I mean, it was really a head trip. I mean, it was really wonderful. But I say that, it sounds like it's about me. It was a major change in the law, and I made a lot of friends and I made a lot of enemies. But the Republican Party was vastly different back then. It was more libertarian than you would relate to. I mean, it was John Love was an immensely decent man, and I had a couple of John Birmingham was a wonderful co-sponsor, and I had another guy named Carl Gustafson who was the majority leader of the Republican Party that was very interesting.
You were in the minority party.
I was in the minority, yeah.
And so, what did the bill do?
Well, it allowed for reasons of for abortion would be health, including mental health, fetal deformity, rape, and incest. It expanded the categories under which an abortion was justifiable.
to those categories.
To those categories.
Those still seem pretty restrictive.
By today's standards, it would be called a very conservative bill, but it was. And we were the first state, but this sort of was in the air. It's funny in American public policy how things, you know, sort of happen in various, spontaneously in various parts. North Carolina and California followed Colorado by just a matter of a month or two. And so it was in the air.
How many Republicans voted for it?
Well, most of the Republicans voted for it.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It was before. In fact, I think this made a really major change in the Republican Party, because I think that a lot of the Phyllis Schlafly type of Republicans said, this is not going to happen anymore. But I started walking this bill around and talking to people very quietly, and both Democrats and Republicans. And there's 100 people in the legislature, as you know, and 65 co-sponsors. I had 65 co-sponsors when I introduced it. And so, you know, it was a tumultuous hearing, and it was a tumultuous time.
I'm always amazed how much Colorado is at the vanguard of political change.
Yeah.
Whether it was abortion, whether it was the first state by referendum to give women the vote, the Taxpayer Bill of Rights, term limits, marijuana. I mean, these are major shifts.
Sunshine law.
Sunshine law, open meetings laws, open records laws.
Yeah.
You know, they came from this state.
I know.
I don't know if you feel the way I do. I grew up here, and I've always felt that there was something in the soil in this great state that kind of had a respect for good government, had a respect for what I'll call libertarian principles, which might be socially liberal but fiscally very conservative. And so all those things seem to make sense, and I think we're still, I think we still have a lot of that.
I do too.
But I'll also say, and it sounds very pejorative, I think there's a lot of Californians coming in here who buy houses at half the price and bring half their politics.
Yeah. You know, I think that one of the things that, you know, no politician can say it, that politics in Colorado is basically honest, because people will sit back and say, it can't be honest, it's all, you're a bunch of crooks. You know, I've been watching the Colorado legislature for 40 years, and there's only two people that I really thought were abusing the system. And we put one of them in jail.
And you got away with it, never went to jail. So that worked out well.
Right.
Who did we put in jail?
It was Ben Klein.
I had a feeling. Who I served with on the RTD board.
I know that.
It was a fascinating experience, let me tell you. It was less than what? 7 years later that Roe versus Wade happened. I don't support Roe versus Wade. Or let me say it this way. I think it was a flawed decision, only because I don't see anything in the federal constitution that makes this something that's going to be addressed on a federal level. I think this is a state issue.
You can read the Blackmun opinion and you can see exactly how he was confused too. I mean, you know, going into the perumbas of the constitution and the Ninth Amendment, and he reached out pretty far to establish a zone of privacy is what it, beyond which the government does not, you know, should not intrude, and included this in
until the NSA came along, then that zone of privacy went away.
But you know, but the various, you know, this is something that you appreciate, the idea that there's, you know, the government can't put your nose in a lot of Americans' business. And whether or not this was a bridge too far is a very interesting question.
You made a statement on this great interview with our friends at Colorado Public Radio that if more states had done it the way Colorado did, if Roe versus Wade didn't happen, it wouldn't be so contentious now. What did you mean by that?
Well, I think that the democratic process is better than the judicial process. I think that there was a lot of people felt, in our democracy, when you have a vote, when you have a vote of the legislature, people on both sides saying, all right, we gave it our best and we accept the decision. We accept the decisions of our elections, even though we don't like them. But all of a sudden, when a court comes down sort of arbitrarily or seems arbitrarily and says, well, this is the new law, it's just a lot harder to sell. And so if we would have done this in a more, if it would have unfolded, I don't want to say that I was against Roe versus Wade, but I think it is.
Were you? Are you?
No, I believe in Roe versus Wade, but I do think it was, you know, looking back on it, maybe historians will say that it should have gone through, and I tend to think it should have gone through a lot more legislatures first.
It should have, legal profession, it should have stewed in more states before it bubbled
That's
up.
Right. That's right. That's true.
See, I can talk like a lawyer, and I didn't have to go to school. I tell you what, you mentioned about we accept elections. So let me bring you back from 50 years ago all the way to today. I've been wanting to get your take on the Trump phenomenon. And I know you're a big Trumpster, but you were early on the Trump train. You were crazy for Trump. You wore the hats. You wanted to make America great again. Actually, I have no idea where you were on Trump. But first, before you tell me where you're on that, how did this guy connect with so many Americans? Yeah. Enough to win.
Well, lots of more thoughtful people than I have really been taking a look at this and have been talking about it. And what's going on all over the world, you know, sort of a revolt of the middle class, and the idea that there's an elite, whether it's the European Union or whether or not it's the political establishment of the Republican or Democratic Party. I mean, the middle class, mainly the white middle class, is pushing back, and they say, we're tired of you, you know, you people trying to intrude on our lives and make us you know, all your moral sermons.
Well, and I also think there's something about the economics of this, when for a decade we've had anemic growth of, you know, maybe 2% economic growth. And those guys who got out of college and were working as bartenders 10 years ago are still working as bartenders. The difference between 2% growth and 3% growth over the course of a decade is the difference between buying a house, being able to put your kids through college, all sorts of things. Yeah. And I think Trump and Bernie were flip sides of basically the same coin. People who are just angry that they don't feel like they've got a part of the American dream.
You know, we all have such faith in democracy. But I think that, you know, John Adams, no less a person than John Adams, said never was a democracy that didn't commit suicide. So under what conditions can democracy continue, or what at wonder point? But I do think it needs a growing pie. I think that you've got to lift up the poor. You've got to have people improving their lot. And since 1973 in America, there's been essentially no growth in the average family income. And that's really been very tough on people.
You know, from my point of view, of course, it's because we're overregulated, we're overtaxed. We have 3,700 governments in this state alone. You know, guys I know put a fence around their front porch on their restaurant. It was over by an inch and they had to pull it out. I mean, that's kind of the stuff that makes it so difficult for people to take the risk to create wealth. I think others look at it and go, no, it's because wealth has been concentrated into so few people, and they don't want it to be spread around, and so we've got to pull it out of them and give it. Which way?
Well,
or is that a false dichotomy?
You know, I'm very attracted to the argument that also that democracy grows barnacles on the hull of the ship of state, and there's so many lobbyists and there's so many special interests, and you go,
you didn't make up that phrase, did you? Because if you did, I'm stealing it.
Well, you look at what happened to Japan and Germany. They completely destroyed their system and they started anew, and they really built really growing economies. And so what you have is, you know, for people, you know, what was the, how much subsidy is in there a gallon of milk? What was the last pay raise of the mailman?
Right.
You and I don't know, but
right.
You think they know? They sure as hell know. And so you have special interest democracy. And
you have, I see it at the Capitol.
You know, you sure
Xcel
do.
Energy runs that Capitol, and the teachers union runs that Capitol. And regular people don't, because we're too busy working. We don't have a concentrated interest there, even though we're most of the people and one's paying it. What's the solution, do you think? Will there be, are we getting close to the end of a two-party system? Or does one of the parties destroy itself and come up again?
Are we getting to the end of a great nation? Are we getting, you know, I mean, that, you know, Toynbee said, Arnold Toynbee, the great historian, said, you know, great nations rise and great nations fall. And he said, the autopsy of history is suicide. He said, they're not overrun near as often. And he'll go back, he looked at 13 great civilizations, not only Rome and Greece, but a lot of others. And he says, you know, they fall for their internal excesses. And so I do think that there is a, you know, there's a certain time limit that you, now Rome had 1,000 years. They had 500 years of the empire and 500 years of the republic. And so I do think that America can have a second act. but I think we are becoming sclerotic. I think we have a hardening of the arteries in terms of the democratic process.
You know why I consider you a friend? It's because every time I talk to you, I just get very cheery and optimistic.
Yeah, I know. It's
amazing.
I teach these wonderful young students, you know. I'm teaching freshman honor students right now. And I look at them so full of brim and vigor, and I really try to say, look, remember, first of all, number one, I could be wrong, maybe. There's a couple of books. Matt Ridley, who you're probably familiar with, wrote a book called The Rational Optimist, and he says that these students that I'm teaching right now are going to all of them be wealthy as Louis the 14th, the sun god. You know, that there's a new book out now also called Abundance, which I say, and so, you know, there's...
But also, what is it... Tom Friedman's
Thank You for Being Late.
I mean, it really talks about Moore's Law in computing power and how the democratization of the whole planet happens because of technology, and there could be real opportunities there.
Lots of positive signs, lots of negative signs. The federal debt, you sort of do a list of what's positive and what's negative, and you see which one, we're gonna be alive, we're gonna know, you know, I think, on how this thing works out, because I think we're coming to a certain tipping point.
For me, and you mentioned it at the beginning, that the entitlement state is the signature of death for us, because we have given transfers of wealth to the needy, to those people who are handicapped, who need extra help. We've done it mostly throughout our history through private charities. Now we're doing it more through government. But in the last 50 years, the growth of middle class entitlements, where now we're going to get our Social Security, we're going to get our VA benefits, we're going to get our Obamacare benefits, we're going to get Medicaid, and it just keeps going. And there's no money there for it. You know, and when you talk to somebody who's charging up their credit cards, you can look at them and go, this is going to end badly for you.
I don't see
how it ends well.
Newt Gingrich in 1994 put together the Contract for America, we all remember, and one of the platforms of that was he was going to abolish 1,000 programs. They won. The Republicans took over the House, they took over the Senate, and they won. And how many programs did they abolish? And I don't say this critically, because I think that he was on the right track. You know, I say this admirably, but only to reinforce the point that you just made. Can democracy downsize?
Can you vote yourself a cut from the national treasury or the state treasury or your county treasury? And you can't. It's not in your personal interest to do so. Was it Jefferson who said democracy is doomed as soon as voters understand they can vote themselves raises?
Well, President Reagan used to quote a bunch of an ancient Scotchman that you really had that saying that the inevitable result of a democracy would be economic chaos. And Plato and Aristotle, you go way back there when democracy was start being experimented in. Plato did not believe democracy was a sustainable form of government. And so, you know, democracy has been good to me, and I don't want to do anything else but there's a question of whether or not democracy...
A benevolent dictatorship. Singapore ain't doing so badly.
Maybe. But it's what you say, that a democracy can't downsize. It can't. And so once you start a series of programs... Now, Canada in about the same time, 1994, they ran into such problems, and they had in a parliamentary system, sort of everybody locked arms, and they were able to pull that back from disaster. But in the American political system, I don't think is equal to the magnitude of the problems that it faces.
Let me throw this out as possible solutions. The states are laboratories. The states are really no longer laboratories. They are on the federal hook. So we can't try new innovations. Colorado has a balanced budget amendment. It can't spend more than it takes in unless it goes to the people. The feds don't have that. And they can go into debt anytime they want, and they can have programs they can't pay for, and they can print money. The M2 money supply since Obama has more than doubled. I think the M1 is more than four times gone up. And I'm wondering, when is the price inflation going to hit as well? And so, this is wishful thinking. Is there something in this Trump craziness that actually disrupts the federal government enough that it liberates the states to start innovating, trying new things, and doing what you did back in 1967, try something and see if other states follow or don't.
Well, the you know that Trump has given no leadership on the entitlement problem, or even on the budget deficit. So, but maybe I mean, if you have the states are should be laboratories of change, and it's a wonderful, wonderful thing when you see it working. It's a wonderful process. And right now, I mean, I had to put together there's 138 job training programs, most of them federal programs, and to try to make sense of this thing, you know, the federal government is. 6% or 7% of our school funding, and it's 39% of our paperwork, or it was back, right. back when I was doing it. I mean,
be, and it's more now.
I have a lot of sympathy with what some of the things you're, that you're saying here.
And voters here, we want to give more money to police, we want to give more money to your schools, and they think the federal government, that's their job. Yeah. Or you know, we want to crack down on sexual crimes. Well, when the states have laws on the books, you know, now you're now it's becoming a federal crime, which is a whole nother level of bureaucracy. It's just
a little, it's a little esoteric, but Richard Nixon had what he called new federalism. And new federalism was a resorting. The federal government takes this and this, but doesn't take everything. I mean, what we have now is picket fence federalism, you know, that every program has a state, local, and federal component. That's crazy. That's crazy. So Richard Nixon came, and I don't often praise Richard Nixon, understand, but, you know, he was right. If we could resort and say, you take the schools and we'll take welfare, and I mean, whatever else it is, but you simplify the various functions of government that you consider necessary.
Talking about the future, you mentioned your college class, and I want to thank you for inviting me so often to come and get bludgeoned by your students. It's
you give as good as you take.
And it's really wonderful. And what drives me nuts is not so much that, you know, I think these kids are stupid because they're young, but they don't know who you are. And I'm like, oh my God, you stupid little twerps, damn millennials or whatever they are now. But you've been doing this now for a long time at the University of Denver, and you love it, and now you're retiring.
And now I'm retiring.
Why?
Yes. Well, I turn 82 in August, and I'm retiring on my 82nd birthday. And I think that that I'm feeling that I'm still young and vigorous enough. Believe it or not, I mean, I really genes have been good to me. I still feel really very good, and I want to explore another side of me. You know, it's there's a whole bunch of different people that talk about. You know, when you're almost into port, that this is a time to sort of sit and reflect and develop other things. I've joined a men's poetry group.
My God, that is just disgusting.
Yeah, it
is. You of all people. Why don't you go join a hunting lodge?
Well,
or a poker group.
I'm open. Well, I have a men's group too. Actually, it's that kind of. You know, my wife has all these. She has a book club and women's group, and you know, women are so good at this,
and
men aren't.
Let me be sexist. Women build relationships with other women that last a lifetime. Guys often identify themselves with whatever job they have and what work they do, and when that ends, you look around and you feel pretty lonely.
We did a bicycle trip. The guy that runs bicycle trips out of Florence, Italy, and he was describing the difference between American men and American women. And so American women, if they get to a hill, and they'll say, you know, good going, Grace, keep going, good girl, you know, good going, go girl. And then the men, you know, I'll beat your butt.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's just, the difference is so night and day.
That's also how men compliment each other. They insult each other.
That's true. That's a really good
thing. That's how you show affection. And I've gotten into a lot of trouble with that because that's more of an East Coast thing, and I must have gotten that through my genes from my folks. But that kind of, you son of a bitch, you know, and people think I'm serious.
Yeah.
So it's a different thing. What do you think you'll be doing when you reflect? You've written several books. Another one?
Probably do a book, but it's a lot of hours to fill up. I mean, I really... But I'm open to a lot. I'm open to a lot of things. Just thinking about and open. But I love to read, and so I can read a lot of the time. I'd like to go and read, read more in history. And I really just think if I do nothing productive, it will still be okay.
I think you've earned it. Yeah, I think you don't.
John, I was 12 years old. My father brought me into his study, and he said, "Men must work." And a week.
And you're 12 years old.
A week later at a paper route. I know. I mean, this work is, it's a very dangerous time in a man's life, too, you know. This is a lot of mortality after the.
After you lose that.
Yeah.
Out of all the different jobs you've had, from being a state legislator to being a governor to being a candidate for U.S. Senate, candidate for president in the Reform Party, which one was the most satisfying? One do you think back and go,
being in the legislature? Yeah.
More so than governor.
Governor was satisfying. I don't want to say I loved it. I loved doing it. But being in the legislature, it was so new and it was so fun to see all of these issues coming down and being able to, like molding clay, that you could make a difference in this area. I really loved the legislature. It was a frenetic time because you had to earn a living and being in the legislature.
What did you get paid back then?
$6,000 a year, as I remember. I hope I'm not mistaken.
No, I think you're right.
Yeah, it was.
And it got bumped up to a whole 17, and now it's at like 30.
Yeah.
But when I was on the RTD board, I got $250 a month.
I know.
And a bus pass. And let me tell you, the ladies like a man with a bus pass.
Well, there's a lot of sacrifice. People like you, I'm ever more aware about how our democracy and our government runs on the virtually volunteer efforts of a lot
but
of good
it's
people.
It's different now than when you were governor, in that the politics of personal destruction are so heavy that you run and you cross a group and they're going to take you out, not because of your policy, but because they found out you tried cocaine when you were 18, or that your ex-wife did this, or you had an affair, or all this other stuff. And we're asking good people to put themselves up to that, and we wonder why we get crazy people representing us.
You know, is it the Bible that says these things too shall pass? I mean, I just hope that this is a phase and we'll go back to the other day, because it is so destructive. And you do ask to yourself, how does anybody in their sane mind want to get too much involved in politics?
Governor Lamm, thank you so much. I just love this. And you, check out the Independence Institute, and we'll see you next week.